what he did for us. Oh my gosh, what he did for us. He is risen, therefore we're forgiven. Hear what I'm saying. He is risen, therefore we're forgiven. How many people are grateful that you're forgiven today? Praise God. God is good. Judgment has been averted. Favor has been granted. We are no longer just enemies. We are more than just strangers. We're more than just friends. We're more than just children. We are joint heirs with Jesus. The most intimate of terms that God is on with you and me because of the blood of Jesus Christ. You know, for just a few minutes this morning on this Easter Sunday morning, and I don't have anything that is what I'd say earth-shattering for you, but just the simple gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen? You know, we want to be so careful never to underestimate what the story of Christ can do. Paul said this, that I am not ashamed. Everyone say not ashamed. Of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. You want to see someone get saved? You share Christ's death and resurrection. Share his sacrifice and his blood, and share what he did in you. Amen? Because Christ is risen, we're forgiven. You know, the living Christ, and we can go to this next slide here. The living Christ, he did a wonderful thing. He blessed people. But the risen Christ transforms people. Did you hear what I said? The living Christ blessed people with teaching and miracles and love, but the risen Christ transforms people with his blood and the power to forgive. I want to ask you a question today. We celebrate as Christians an empty tomb, but I want to ask you today, do you celebrate an empty tomb or a risen Christ? There's a difference between the two. This is an empty tomb. Right now, we see a depiction of Mary Magdalene before the angel speaks to her. She's confused. She's not sure. She's hopeful, but she doesn't know. And this world, guess what? There's no one who disputes that Jesus' tomb was empty on that resurrection Sunday morning. Nobody disputes it. How many people know that? But the question that people dispute is, what happened? What happened to him? And it says in Scripture that there were over 500 witnesses that day who saw him. Do you think these people would have died for that kind of lie? Do you think they would have been persecuted unto death for some kind of hoax? Jesus is risen, amen? You see, it's an important question to ask ourselves. Are we just celebrating an empty tomb? Or change that slide, Anthony, if you would. Or are we celebrating the risen Christ? You see, because for Mary Magdalene, when she realized that the gardener was no gardener, but that he was the Savior of the world, it was her Lord and Savior, Jesus, it changed everything, didn't it? It changed everything. Understand, the risen Christ changes everything in our lives. I want you to think of Peter. He denied his Savior. Why? Out of fear. And that brought such a great guilt to his life. And we know that after Jesus has died, him and the other disciples, they're hiding. Yet after Jesus has risen and Jesus has restored him, we know that he becomes bold and assured in preaching Christ to whoever comes his way. Before that, he tried to strike, he tried to deny, and he tried to run. Peter tried it all. Maybe you've run from Jesus. Maybe you've struck out at others. Maybe you've denied or tried to use your mouth. Understand, Peter did it all, and none of it worked until he found Christ's forgiveness in his life. Amen? Paul, the Apostle Paul, man, we said before, he was the first religious terrorist. He hated Christians. He had them murdered. He was deeply offended by Christ. Yet when he met the risen Christ on the road to Damascus, understand that he became a faithful servant who was bound by his Savior by love and thanksgiving. Some of us at one time were offended by the gospel. Maybe many of us know those that still are. They are not beyond the grace of God. They just don't need to hear the facts. They need to meet the risen Christ. Amen? They need to go from the empty tomb to the living God. That's what they need to go to. Another one, Mary Magdalene. This woman was demon-possessed and she was a prostitute. And we know that she became a devoted follower of Christ. You know, she was the first one to the tomb, and she was the first one to see him risen. Amen? She was the first one to see him risen and to find that peace in her heart where others were fearful. It says that she was filled with fear and with joy. That's what Scripture says. Fear and joy. It's wonderful to have fear and joy inside of yourselves. You may say, you want fear? Fear of God with joy is a marvelous thing. It's an exciting thing. Keeps us honest too. Amen? Yeah. You see, Mary Magdalene, she was transformed by the risen Christ. Never to be the same. I want you to see the scripture here up on the board. If Christ, this is what Paul said, if Christ has not risen from the dead, then our faith is what? Empty. Those who have fallen asleep have perished. We are dead in our sins and we are most pitiable indeed. That's what Paul said. If Christ hasn't risen, we are pitiable. Can you imagine what we do as Christians? We give of our time and our resources. There are those who give of their luxuries and their comforts, and those who've even given of their lives for a message. Can you imagine? For a message. You know, I was intrigued at looking at the history of the Civil War, something called the Pony Express. Anyone ever heard of the Pony Express? These men were amazing as they would ride hours on horses, and horses were set up at intervals so that they'd always have a fresh horse, and they'd jump on one horse and they'd ride as fast as they could, and they'd jump off and jump on another horse and ride as fast as they could. They would ride through any kind of weather and any kind of danger in order to get the message to the other side. There have been many in war who have died over getting the message to the other side. Understand, Christ wants us to get the message to the other side. Are you willing to be a messenger for him? You see, he has risen from the dead. We haven't wasted our resources. We haven't wasted our time. In fact, if anything, our time has equaled souls when God blesses the messenger. Amen? You know, Peter did deny, and he ran out because of shame. The Pharisees all tried to silence Jesus out of their own self-righteousness, their own offense, and their own pride, many of them. Judas, he betrayed Jesus because of selfish gain. You know something? We all suffer from that fear. We have all suffered from that shame. We have all suffered from that selfishness and that self-righteousness and that offense and that pride. Is there anyone here who says, I haven't been there at one time or another? Every single one of us. We judge no one in this story. All we do is thank Jesus because on the cross, as he hung there and he bled, he said, Father, forgive them. That was his mission. It wasn't a glib statement. It wasn't just a nice Christian thing to do. It was his pronunciation to all mankind and to all heaven and earth for history, past, present, and future, that, Lord, it is accomplished. Forgive them. And when he said it is finished, you, myself, the Pharisees, Mary, Peter, all these folks were forgiven. I want you to know that potentially those that don't know Christ are forgiven. They need to know about him. Amen? They need to know about him. On that cross, Christ said, it is finished. Now get this. He didn't say, I am finished. He said, it is finished. Amen? He said, it is finished. You see, each and every one of us have a choice. And we'll change that slide. Each and every one of us have a choice. You can let your sin keep you from Christ, or you can let Christ keep you from your sin. Which will you choose? See, the only thing that separates those two statements is pride. The only thing that separates those two statements is fear. The only thing that separates those two statements is self-righteousness. I've been plagued by them all at times. How about you? But when we yield to Christ's sacrifice, when we yield to his blood, when we yield to his love, understand, the risen Christ transforms his people. Amen? Are you a transformed being in Christ Jesus? Have old things passed away? Have all things become new for you? Are now all things in your life of God? I need to hear that sometimes because sometimes I don't allow all things to be God and of God. And I take those things back and I go through situations and I get all, you know what I'm saying, right? And then all of a sudden I got to remember all things are of God now. I've got to filter all these things through God. He hasn't left us or forsaken us.
How about this scripture? I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things about to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other living creature can separate us from Christ Jesus. Amen? Isn't that wonderful? Understand that God's love was poured out through us through Jesus Christ. Listen to me. The price was paid, the Savior was raised, and the sinner was saved on this day so many years ago. Can you say that his death and resurrection has been effective in your life? Have you received him as your Savior? Have you said, Lord, I'm not going to let my sin get in the way of you, but Lord, I'm going to let you take away my sin. It's hard sometimes. I won't lie to you. I think sometimes we sort of comfort our sin and we sort of hold it close. Now you say, no, I don't, Pastor. Yes, you do. If you just resist it, yes, you do. See, we can be stubborn sometimes. How many people know a stubborn attitude is sin? Holding on to our fear and feeling sorry for ourselves is sin. How many people know that? Many times we think of the biggies, you know, the sex, drugs, and rock and roll, you know? You know my sex, drugs, and rock and roll story? God saved me from all of it. Thank God. Amen? But listen to me. It's only our own stubbornness that keeps us from the sacrifice of Christ. You know, I believe there are many who need to be convinced, and there's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with a convincing argument, and we should give a convincing argument and be able to help those to understand that. But there are also many who use that in order not to receive Christ. Listen to me. Entertaining other voices in our lives, especially when the enemy speaks in our head, that can be sin too. How many people know that? If we're not entertaining Christ's voice. You know, in Luke 24, which Greg opened up with, towards the end of that passage, we know that on the third day, Christ rises again, and the women go down to the tomb, and he's not there, and the angels speak to them, and they run back, and the disciples, Peter and John, run back, and Christ is no longer there, and we know that that Mary, thinking that Jesus is dead, she thinks it's the gardener, and it ends up being Christ, and then they go back and tell the other disciples, and the other disciples say, you're nuts, and they close the door, right? And after all of this, we know that Jesus appears to the disciples, doesn't he? He appears to them and he shows them his hands. He shows them his side and he says, believe me, peace be unto you. You know, if you ask Jesus to show you, he will. If there's something in your heart today that says, Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief, he will. The question is, will you entertain your unbelief or will you entertain the word of God? I have a good friend, just does not believe that this is God's word. And he's always trying to give me some argument to show me that I'm wrong. And I said, this has nothing to do with me being wrong. It has everything to do with God's word. And I trust God's word more than I trust your doubts. Why would I trust human doubt over divine inspiration? Why would I do that? Wouldn't that be arrogant of us to trust our own doubts over divine inspiration? Yet this man does. I pray for him. I pray that God will do a work of grace in him. He's a good man. You know, in Luke 24, verse 44, Jesus, he gives his final word to his disciples before he sends into heaven. And I want you to see this because I believe this is so important for each and every one of us. As on this Resurrection Sunday morning, as we remember what Christ did, Christ comes back to the very essence of what he did and what he wants to do in us and through us. And we want to take a look at this just for a few minutes this morning. The first thing we want to say is that Christ is risen. How many people said amen?
Amen.
Amen. Do you believe his promises? Look what the scripture says. The scripture is so good. Then he said to them, these are the words which I spoke to you. I spoke to you. Jesus said these words to his disciples while I was still with you. That means Jesus told his disciples about his death and his resurrection before he died, right? He says, this is what I was telling you. But if you look in the Bible, it says they didn't understand, did they? In fact, Peter tried to talk him out of it, didn't he? Then he called Peter Satan. You know, it's amazing. You see, a bloodless gospel, a crossless gospel is not a gospel. Hear what I just said? A bloodless gospel and a crossless gospel is not a gospel because there's no sacrifice. Anyway, these are the things I spoke to you while I was still with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law. All things must be fulfilled. How many people know the whole Old Testament points to Jesus Christ? When Jesus says, look what he says. He says the law of Moses, that's the Torah, the first five books. The prophets, how many people know? That's all the different prophets from Isaiah, Ezekiel, Micah, right? So many of them, right? And then it even says the Psalms. Is there anything left out? Mm-mm. Jesus is saying the entire Old Testament pointed to him. And he said, look what he says, must be fulfilled, those things that were written. That word fulfilled is a really cool word. It's the word plerao. Everyone say plerao. I always think of Plato when I think of plerao. I don't know why. It just reminds me of Plato. But plerao means to fill or fulfill. Now, this is really important. Now, I want you to think of something being filled up. Now, a few years ago, we were trying to raise money to finish up some renovations here at the church. And as we did that, we did one of those little thermometers. And we needed to fill the thermometer with the red. How many people know what I'm talking about, right? And we start getting nervous because all of a sudden there's more white than red in the thermometer, right? but anyway, when the thermometer was filled up, we knew the funds were ready and we were ready to go. You see, the whole idea of being fulfilled means to be filled or accomplished, to be ready and accomplished for that purpose. You see, promises were made in the Old Testament. He made a promise to, that's all, folks. He made a promise to Adam and Eve. And he said to them that your seed will be at enmity with the seed of the enemy, but you will bruise his heel, but your seed, Eve, will bruise his head. Then he said to Abraham, in your seed, Abraham, all the nations of the earth will be blessed. And then he said, offer up Isaac. And Abraham showed such faith in Christ, because it says in Hebrews, when Abraham was ready to sacrifice his son, it says in Hebrews, he knew that God would have risen him from the dead. Could Abraham have thought that maybe his son was the Messiah? The sacrifice? You know, it goes on. He goes into David and he says, you know, from David, I'm going to make a promise that from you and your kingdom, that this king will come and his kingdom will be forever. God made promises in the Old Testament about this Messiah and this kingdom that would come. And Jesus said, all these things must be filled up. They must be accomplished. And they are accomplished in Christ Jesus. Amen. The things that I told you, the things that God has told you in Scripture, the prophets, all these things point to him. This is not some idea that a few people came up with after Jesus died. Amen? And he opened their understanding and they might comprehend the Scriptures. The question is, will you believe in his promises? You see, the disciples had a hard time believing in it. You know why? They saw him die. Even though he said, I gotta die, I have to die on the cross, I have to cry this cruel death. How many people know when they saw him on the cross, it was tough? Guys, we're in the same boat today. Jesus told us what the end times would be. We're living in them right now. And how many of us say, oh, this is horrible? Yeah, it is. But don't lose faith in what you see around you, because Christ said it was going to happen. And how many people know, although in the physical it might look dismal, in the spiritual, God is ready to move in a powerful way. Amen? Jesus is coming again. Will you believe his promises to you? Christ said it in the word, the prophets all pointed to it. His spirit speaks to your heart. He's risen, amen? The next thing we'll say, because he's risen, we're forgiven. We're forgiven. Look what the scripture says. Then he said to them, thus it is written. How many times did Jesus say that? I'll tell you, those are three very powerful words. It is written. Aren't they? Before we move on, it is written. How many people... You get into the Word of God and you know the Word of God. Please look at, we don't read Bible to get brownie points with God. God doesn't feel better about us because we read a Bible or not read a Bible. But listen to me, faith comes by what? Hearing what? The Word of God. If you don't read about him, you don't know about him. All you can do is hope. I hear a lot of this with people. I'd like to think that God is. You don't have to think that God is. You can know that God is. Just open the book and read it. Amen? Faith comes by hearing. As we see these scriptures, it brings truth to us. Jesus says, it is written. That means it came from the mouth of God and it can't be changed. God doesn't change his mind, does he? Thus it is written, and it was necessary. Everyone say necessary. Necessary for the Christ to suffer and rise from the dead. Jesus was not a tragedy. He was a triumph. Jesus was not a victim. He was a victor. Amen. And listen to me, in your lives, as you go through situations and I go through situations, we are not victims. We are victors in Christ Jesus. We are not tragedies. We are triumphs in Christ Jesus. And we don't for a moment want to take that victim role, because we have been redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ. God uses all things to good for those who love him and are called according to his purposes. Don't you worry about what you're facing right now. God is going to use it for his glory and for your growth. Amen. I love what it says. It was necessary for the Christ to suffer and rise from the dead the third day, that repentance and remissions of sin should be preached in his name. Repentance. You know what that means? That our minds would change. We got that word from the Holy Spirit this morning. That was beautiful. How many people know we need the Holy Spirit to repent? We do. You know why? The Holy Spirit convicts us of our sin. How many people know that? You see, when we don't want to repent, we're resisting the Holy Spirit. When I want to be stubborn, and sometimes I am, I'm resisting the Holy Spirit. How about you? Tell me I'm not the only sinner here. Please, please tell me. You see, we can resist him, but understand repentance can only come because of what Christ did on the cross. And look what it says, the remission of sins, the remission of sins. That literally in the original language means the taking away of sins, the carrying away of sins. Your sin could not be carried away without Jesus' sacrifice on the cross. Scripture says, he who knew no sin became sin. He carried your sin away so that we might become, say it with me, the righteousness of God. He gave you his righteousness. He took your sin. It could not have happened without the cross. Because of that, we are forgiven. Amen? More than forgiven, says Scripture, says that we have God's favor now. How many people know that? We just said it a few minutes ago. We said more than just children, more than just sons, that's in the Father's likeness, we are heirs. Joint heirs with Christ Jesus. The inheritance of heaven is yours because of what Christ did on the cross. Do you think of the things of heaven, or do you just lament about the things of earth? Do you rejoice in the things of heaven, or do you just complain about the things of earth? You see what I'm saying? We have a choice of where we're going to look today, don't we? And I know that some things in our world look very dismal today, but it is our choice, it's your choice, and it's my choice to say where I will fix my eyes. And I'll tell you, my eyes must be fixed on Jesus Christ, because there is nowhere else that I can find my redemption. We sang it this morning, I know my Redeemer lives. Amen? And I will rejoice, listen to this, in the land of the living. That man Job lived over 6,000 years ago, and guess what? He's not dead, he's in the land of the living, and he's rejoicing. Guys, I know we say sooner or later we're all gonna die. Well, I guess there's a physical truth to that. I'm have to do a lot more sit-ups to keep this from sagging. I'm sure you're the same way. We had three very busy days here, and I got up this morning, I said, happy, oh, ooh. And it took about a half hour to get everything moving. You know, you guys know what I'm talking about, right? You know, thinking about the Grecian formula now a little bit, you know? But listen to me, that's only this body. Listen to me, it's only the body. How many people know that God revived your spirit? You who were dead in our trespasses and sin have now been made alive in Christ Jesus, amen? And we rejoice because our life is forever. This is just the end of the beginning. How many people know that? Just the end of the beginning. Will you embrace his plan? A lot of people will tell you what they think Jesus did on the cross. They'll tell you, I love this, the true, we get this at Christmas time too. The true meaning of Christmas, goodwill towards men. God's goodwill towards men, right? The true meaning of Easter, bunnies, chocolate, right? I love peanuts. Did anyone ever see Charlie Brown Christmas special? The true meaning of Christmas, money, money, money. See, there's only one meaning to Christmas, God's gift to mankind, Jesus Christ, and it's fulfilled at Easter, forgiveness. Sacrifice and forgiveness. It's the only meaning that Easter can have. It's the only meaning that Resurrection Sunday can have is forgiveness, a future and a hope because of what Christ did on the cross. Because he has risen, we are forgiven. Will you embrace his plan, or are you gonna try to come up with another one? There are a lot of people today, even in what we call Christianity, who've come up with their own plan for God. And they'll tell you God's got this elaborate plan for you. All I know is that I have been forgiven, and he's told me he's given me a future and a hope. Isn't that wonderful? And in that, there are wonderful, wonderful benefits, many benefits that are there. There's healing, there's power, there's hope, there's joy, there's blessing. But listen to me, they all emanate out of one thing, the blood of Jesus Christ, which has forgiven my sin and made me right with the Father. Amen? Will you embrace his plan? Will you believe his promises? And will you embrace his plan, especially in this late day of history? And the last thing we're going to see is that he's called us to a great co-mission. Everyone say co-mission. Now, listen, I'm not having a problem with pronunciation, okay? I don't have a syllable problem right now. Now, it's funny because if you're from the South, how many people know you put the emphasis on certain syllables and not others? My brother Don has been down in Tennessee now for about 30 years. And when I talk to him, he says things very differently than me. You know what I'm saying? In fact, his children, I tease my niece and nephew sometimes. I said, there's no way you're related to me. Hi, Uncle Byatt, how are you? It's like, when we all get together, it's like the Balboas meet the Clampets. It really is. That's what it's like. You know what I mean? We're from Jersey, you know, New York, New Jersey. Right? Yeah. Anyway, understand, we all have a commission. What do we mean by this? You see, we talk about the Great Commission, and we have been commissioned by God to go out. But listen to me, that commission is not something we have to do. It's something we do with Christ. It's a co-mission. I mean, it's a mission that is by two people, by two, more than one person here. Christ is part of it. The first thing that we see, because he's risen and we're forgiven, he wants our participation. Look what it says here. And you are witnesses of these things. Now, I want to ask you, if you've been redeemed by the blood of Jesus, would you raise your hand? You are a witness. You are a witness not only to what this word tells you, but you are a witness to that cleansing power of Christ Jesus. You are a witness to that great exchange of forgiveness that's happened in your heart. You are a witness to the joy that he gives to his children. Understand that you are witnesses of these things. Just as the early disciples were literally witnesses to his resurrection bodily, we are all witnesses to his resurrection spiritually. How many people know that? This is what he said to Thomas. He said, Thomas, you believe because you've seen, but blessed are those who believe who have not seen. But they have, I'm adding this, Gospel of Matthew, Jones, they have experienced. Have you experienced the forgiveness of your Savior? Then you are a witness. Now, don't take me wrong. Evangelism explosion was a great thing, and Christian Equippers International, they just sent me like another mailing. That's a great thing, and there's a lot of great methods for witnessing to people out there, but there will never be a more effective witness than you telling people what Christ did in your life. Amen? You see, that word witness is the word martus. Everyone say martus. Anyone know what word we get out of martus? Martyr. Because the early Christians who died, they were, get this, it means they were eyewitnesses. That's what martyrs means, an eyewitness. Guess what? Channel 11, Eyewitness News. That's what they were. People who saw it. You know, when the reporter goes up, hey, you saw that house blow up. What happened? Well, I saw smoke coming out, and I saw people running out, and golly gee, the whole thing blew up. You wouldn't believe it. There was screaming and yelling. The fire department came, and everyone's going, ooh, we got to hear what this guy has to say. Why? Because he was an eyewitness. Listen to me. You know what you're saying and I'm saying? I couldn't believe it. I was dead in my sin and trespasses. I was troubled. I was hurt and I was weary. I had given up hope on everything else. And then I met Jesus. And Jesus offered to take away my sins. I resisted him for so long. But finally, when I received him, an amazing thing happened. My heart was lifted. I felt his forgiveness. I experienced this new life that he says he could give to me. I'll no longer be the same. I'm an eyewitness. Are you an eyewitness? Be an eyewitness. That's the heart of witnessing, is just telling someone else what happened to you. Now listen, if you can't articulate what Christ did for you, ask him to make you an eyewitness. You see, if it's just something that you know and you believe, that's good. That's a very good thing. But remember we said, the living Christ blesses, but the risen Christ transforms. Maybe today you need to go from the living Christ to the risen Christ. Maybe you need to go from blessing and believing to transformation, receiving his forgiveness for you personally. There's a lot of people, and I've shared over the years, and I'll ask you the question, do you believe that God created the world in 6 days? Yeah, a few people do. Good. And do you believe that God saved this world with an ark? Yeah. Do you believe that the sun stood still when they were in battle against the enemy because God called it? Do you believe that when they were in battle, when they raised Moses' hands up, they would win, and when his hands went down, they would start to lose? And when his hands went back, they would. Do you believe that? Then can you believe God for your marriage? Can you believe God for your finances? Can you believe God for your wayward children? Can you believe God for your unbelieving parents? You see, if we say we believe these stories, will you believe his story for you? It's no different for you. It's only receiving his forgiveness. It's believing what he said is true and saying, Lord, I'm gonna trust you. It doesn't mean there's no fear in our hearts. It doesn't mean that there are not other voices in our head, but it's who we choose to listen to. Amen? I can listen to those negative voices and worry about those negative voices and start to just obsess over those negative voices, or I can listen to what Jesus said. Remember, Jesus said, these were the things I told you. Guess what? The disciples were obsessing over the voices of Pilate and Roman soldiers. They were obsessing over the voices of Pharisees, but they weren't obsessing over the voice of Jesus and what he told them. See, that's why you have the Holy Spirit. You have a new voice inside of you. Let me say that again. One of the big reasons God gave you the Holy Spirit is to give you a new voice inside of you. There's all those voices out there, but there is a compass that God has placed in me through his Holy Spirit that can't be denied. Some people in the world call it your gut. You know what the Bible calls it? Discernment. Amen? And the Holy Spirit bears witness of Christ in you. Not only does he want our participation by making us martyrs or eyewitnesses or witnesses of what he's done, that's the heart of serving him. But look what he says here, behold, I send, well, that's cool, the promise of my Father. Now, if the Father promised something, you think God's not gonna send it to you? If the creator of the world promises something, you think he's gonna go back on it? No, I send you the promise of my Father, but tarry in the city of Jerusalem. That means wait. It means wait, hang on, don't lose faith, don't get weary. How many of us can't wait for more than 30 seconds? I gotta wait for more than 30 seconds, the iPhone comes out. Facebook, email, texting. Oh, this is a nice new app. Let me make a new movie. Yes, you all saw me doing my videoing today. It's a sickness. Pray for me. I don't know how to get away from making videos. It's crazy. I think I'm like Cecil B. DeMille or something. I don't know. Anyway. Behold, I send you the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry in the city of Jerusalem, look at this, until you are what? Endued with power. Endued, you need power. Amen? How many people need power? Say, yes, Pastor, I need power, and don't call me dude. Right? Yeah. We need to be endued with power, don't we? You know what the word endued means? It's really cool. I looked it up. It literally means to be clothed. In fact, it means to sink into cushy clothing. Now, last night, it was pretty cold, and all the cast members said, amen. Yes, it was very cold last night. poor Josh and Jake Josh, two Joshes up there, and they weren't joshing us. It was cold last night, you know, and I felt bad for them. They were in a diaper last night. I mean, for crying out loud, I looked at them and I said, look at that. Wow, that's almost obscene. You got a biblical diaper on and that's it, you know, but they were up on that cross and they were freezing to death. And I have no idea why I'm telling you this right now. But anyway, when we were all finished, what happened was they all ran in, you know, and everyone put their jackets on. And I remember going home, I was in the car and the heat was up and the stereo was going, and I went like this. You guys know what I'm talking about, don't you? After being cold? Yeah, poor me with my three layers of clothing and my jacket. Sorry, Jesus's. Anyway, I got home and I got in my pajamas. I tried to watch the Ten Commandments. I couldn't stay awake for it this year. That's like my favorite movie. Like, isn't that an incredible movie? Cecil B. DeMille, that was some movie he made, isn't it? Anyway, I got in bed and I went, You know, endued, that's what that means. You've been clothed and you snuggle in. Understand that God has power for you. He has strength for you to be witnesses. He has power and strength for us to live a life before God. He has power and strength for us to be devoted to him. He's got power and strength for us to believe in him. And he said, I want you to just take on that clothing and just snuggle into it. Would you be clothed today with his power? If you've been clothed with his righteousness, you could be clothed with his power today. You don't have to walk this alone. Didn't we call this a co-mission? He told us to be eyewitnesses, but he also said, I'm going to clothe you with power. Now that's pretty cool, isn't it? Just like Iron Man. Tony Stark. He's just Tony Stark. He's a little guy like me. Thor punches him out. The guy's going to go flying across the room, right? And all of a sudden, he's clothed in this iron thing and nobody can touch him, right? Understand, in the same way, God says, I want to clothe you with power. Power against worry. Power against fear. Power against sickness. Power to share. Do you want that power? You can snuggle into that garment. God's given us a garment. He's given us his righteousness, that's a garment. He's given us his praise, that's a garment. And there's another garment he says to put on his power. Amen? And then the last thing that we see here today as we have this commission, I love this, he gives us reason for praise. Now, you don't have to be empty in your praise. You don't have to go, oh, thank God today, I'm not sure why, but praise you, Lord, anyway. Praise the Lord anyway. Praise the Lord anyway. In fact, we're going to start a whole new worship song called Praise the Lord Anyway. Right? You don't need to say praise the Lord anyway. Listen to me. He gives us everything. In fact, it says this in Psalm 103. He puts good things in our mouth to say about him because he's merciful. Look at this says here. He led them out as far as Bethany. That word led is a really cool word. It's the word exago. Everyone say exago. It reminds me of that bird on Aladdin. Anyway, exago, right? To bring forth or lead or carry out. Guess what? He leads us all out to where we need to go. And it says he led them out to Bethany. Bethany is a really neat place because in Bethany, that was a home of three of his very, very, very best friends. Mary, Martha, and you name the third. Lazarus, their brother, right? And what happened in Bethany? Poing, Lazarus, come forth, amen? Guess what? Lazarus, Jesus did that with Lazarus before he did it for himself, amen? You see, a great miracle happened. A testimony happened in Bethany. Jesus will always lead you to a testimony. Listen, I don't care what happens. One testimony can last a lifetime. One spiritual encounter can direct us for the rest of our lives in God. And when you're getting discouraged and you're saying, I'm trying to look at Jesus, I can't see him right now, just look back at what he did for you. He leads you to Bethany. He leads you to that place of the testimony. Amen. Then the next thing it says here, he led them as far as Bethany. He lifted up his hands. Look at it says there. What did he do? He blessed them. That's a really neat word. We've said that in the Hebrew. It's the word baruch. Right? And it's a derivative of the word bricha, which is a spring. God is the source of life. Listen to me. When he blessed them, he spoke words of life to them. He's the only source of life. We can bless one another by speaking God's word and God's love. How many people know that? But understand, Jesus is the source of blessing. You know, there are times when he's given me a great testimony in life and still things are not maybe going the way I want or maybe I'm not feeling the way I want. Usually it's not my situation that's the problem. It's usually I'm the problem. Before you think about changing your job, getting rid of your family, before maybe changing churches, before you think about whatever you got to change in your life, maybe stop for a moment and say, maybe it's not the problems in the world. It's the problems in my heart. Listen, guys, we all have anxiety issues, right? We all have them. We all get worried. We all get frustrated. We all have those days where we walk around and our forehead's all wrinkled up. It happens to all of us. But I've come to realize the problem's not my family. It's not Mountaintop Church. It's not New Jersey. Well, maybe. And it's not New Jersey. You know what it is? It's me. It's this sinful heart that needs Jesus Christ. And I need to let him speak words of peace to me, words of life. I need to let him, Baruch, bless me today. Amen? He leads us in that place of testimony. He speaks words of life to us. And if you ask him to today, he'll speak those words of life to encourage you. He'll bring you back to your testimony. He'll bring you back to the blood. He'll bring you back to that forgiveness. He'll lift you up. Amen? And I love what it says. And then he was carried up into heaven. Can you imagine what those disciples saw? Oh my gosh. Give me a change of underwear. Holy cow, right? Can you imagine when they saw Jesus transfigured into heaven? That must have been an amazing thing as he ascended into heaven. That must have been an amazing thing. And look what their response to all of this is. They worshiped him. Isn't that beautiful? They worshiped him. They returned to Jerusalem with what? Joy. Now, you got to remember, they left Jerusalem going, we got to get out of here. We got to get out of town, right? We got to get out of Dodge. They're going to kill us. And they came back going, la-di-da. I got to tell you what happened. Anyone see that new movie? What was the name? Greg, we went to see. What was that again?
Risen.
Anyone see Risen? My favorite character was Bartholomew. And they bring him in. And he's like, hey, man. And the Roman soldiers threaten him, hey, no problem. Jesus is love. Jesus changed my life, you know. And they're ready to all beat him up. And then when the Roman soldier sees the risen Christ, Bartholomew goes, I told you. He's just like so happy, you know. Listen to me. We can have joy because Christ has risen from the grave. You don't have to let the situations of life get you down. You know why? Because you have been redeemed, amen. There's healing in Jesus Christ. There's forgiveness in Jesus Christ. There's an end of shame and sickness in Jesus Christ. If we will only keep our eyes on him, hear his voice of blessing in our lives, go back to that place of testimony. They worshiped him, returned to Jerusalem with great joy. And I love what it says here. They were what? Continually in the temple praising and blessing God. I'm going to tell you right now, if you want to sustain yourself in these days, come to what we call the temple today. Come to the church. You know, Thomas, and I'm going to end with this today. The disciple Thomas, of all the disciples, he was the most passionate. It says at one point when Christ says, I have to go to Jerusalem to die, Thomas says, we will all go and die with you, Jesus. And you know what happened is a short time later after Jesus is crucified, Thomas is so discouraged and so depressed, he separates himself from the other apostles. He does. And so when Jesus first appears to the disciples early on the day of his resurrection, guess what? Scripture says Thomas was not there. No, I think Thomas was probably home watching Match Game 75. I don't know. You know, Hogan's Heroes. I don't know what he was doing, you know. There were a couple guys. One's name was Cleophas. They were getting out of town. They were going to a place called Emmaus. You know what Emmaus means? Hot springs. They said, after all this, we need a vacation. Let's go to hot springs, all right? And that's what they were doing, right? And Jesus met them on the way on vacation. They were going away. Listen to me. All of us do that sometimes. We want to run when we're hurting inside. Thomas separated himself. And remember what happened? Jesus spoke peace to those disciples, and they came up to Thomas, we saw Jesus, we saw Jesus. And Thomas goes, no, unless I see his hands and I see the scars in his side, I will not believe. 8 days, agonizing days, excruciating days, 6 needless days later, Jesus appears to Thomas and says, be believing. We need each other, guys. More than ever in history, we need each other. When we gather and we open the word, when we gather and we worship together, when we work together like we did for the past 3 days for the sake of souls, when we fellowship with one another, we have study together. Listen to me, when we are together, Christ is in our presence. He speaks words of blessing to us. He leads us to a place of testimony. He blesses us and empowers us, and he prepares us for heaven. Amen. Jesus is risen. We are forgiven. Let's give him a word of an offering today. Thank you, Jesus. Bless you, Lord. We thank you that you've forgiven us on the cross of Calvary, Lord God. You've brought healing, Lord God. You've ended our shame. Lord, you're the only one who's worthy of our praise. Hallelujah, Jesus. We bless you, Jesus.